Yesterday, you have seen how Durga used to protect all the seekers, sadhakas, and how she killed the people who have been troubling, torturing, killing the seekers of truth. Her whole advent was to protect them from all these evil forces. In those days, that was the most important work. So that's how the sadhakas came up to these modern times. And now they are seekers of truth, or they have found the truth. All these different passage has taught the sadhakas what is the use of their life. They were frantically first trying to find the truth, frantically, and they went into different difficult places. They thought by going into some lonely places they'll be able to settle their mind in peace and they'll be able to find the truth. Also they sacrificed many things, their wealth which was bothering them, their families they thought was standing in the way of their research. All this went on and there are still some people who believe that by becoming an ascetic one can find this truth. Buddha did the same, Mahavira did the same. Their life was nothing but a great tapasya. Their tapasyas are helping us today in such a way that we now have got such a blessing that our personalities as they are can receive self-realization for which people struggled and struggled. In such a way that if you read that, how they were suffering, you might be really amazed how they went through all this suffering and all this tapasya just with the goal to get their self-realization. It is an ordeal even to read about them and to know about them. And while they were seeking also, there were so many people who tried to trouble them, who tried to torture them, who tried to kill. And the people surrounding them didn't know what they were doing. They used to ridicule them, laugh at them, make fun of them. With all this, what we learned that we have got our self-realization very easily, without any torture, without any ordeal, without any sufferings, fasting, nothing. That's not true, because you are the same people who have done all this before, and that's why you are here. It's your matter of right to have your self-realization. It's no way is to say that without anything we got it, because It is life after life you have been seekers. Whatever path you followed, whatever religion you followed, whatever faiths you followed, it was a torture for you. And this torture is today now fruitful, that today you are self-realized people. But in any way we see that human beings, if they get something rather easily, they don't understand the value of how they got it. Now to get this easily, actually you must know, is not just because you were nothing, you were something great. You were great saints, went into Himalayas, you did all kinds of ordeals and fasting, and where so many of you were killed and butchered in the name of God. So today, whatever you have got, whatever realization you have got, is not just something you should think that it's only Mother's grace that we have got. It's your own great personality which has achieved it. Otherwise it would have been impossible for me to give you realization. Whatever the work the deities have done, they have brought you to this level of human existence, protecting you. But now, naturally, just this is the last step which you have crossed, and you have achieved this self-realization, and so many of you have achieved great heights. This power within us, the Kundalini, which has connected you to this all-pervading power, has been struggling, has been guiding you, has been all the time looking after you, protecting you, so that you should achieve your goal in this Kali Yuga. It was said that only during Kali Yuga this will happen, and those people who are seeking God in the mountains and in the valleys will find it. But they'll be normal people, people who will have household and living like normal people in the society. They won't be some sort of sadhus or saints, but people who are married, who have children, all such people who are leading a very normal life will receive their realization. It's already said, it's already predicted by Bhrigu Muni. So it's all being already set, I think, all being planned. But in this, a credit goes, of course, to you people that you have recognized what is the truth. As you know, there are so many false people going about. They are doing all kinds of tricks, they are trying all kinds of methods to entice people. Despite that, you have recognized. This recognition is something very remarkable, and I am myself surprised how, like lost children finding their mother, come back to her in the same way all of you are here. But in this, we should not think that we have got it easily or we have got it without any difficulties, because this can create a little problem that we will not go further with the same speed, with the same dedication as we have been doing before. So whatever you think is easy was not easy at all. It is sahaja, it is what can say spontaneous, but now it is for you to time, it's really to understand that this time is so important, we have to save the whole world, that you have to project yourself, as I said last time, and to find out ways and methods how you can do these things. In Russia, I must tell you, I had a very good experience of a very highly developed soul who is a very well-known scientist. He is one of the biggest scientists of Russia, and he is indulging also into spirituality. He told people that, "I am indulging into spirituality, I would like to see Mother." I said, "All right, I would love to see him." So when he came, he looked at me and he said, "I know, Mother, that you are the incarnation of God in these modern times." I was quite surprised for a scientist to say that. But his eyes, so pure and so full of devotion and humility. Then he says that, "I want to do something if you help me." I said, "What do you want to do?" He said, I cannot measure your power, I cannot." He had an instrument by which he could measure the power. "I can't also measure the power of your photographs." He said, he told me a number which I couldn't understand, was something 700 raised to power, some sort of a billion into billiardi, like that. I said, "Now what this number is, I don't know." So he told me that this is what your photograph is. So I said, "All right, now what do you want me to do?" I told him, "You can take this photograph if you think it is so powerful." So he took the photograph with such respect and this thing, at least 4 or 5 times he bowed to me. I said, "What do you want to do about it?" He said that, "I want to put it on a satellite." Now see the projection part. Satellite, then what will you do? "And I'm going to put electromagnetic force behind it. So this will, the power that is in this one will penetrate into things, because electromagnet can penetrate, with that these vibrations will also penetrate. So I will go onto the satellite and from there I'll project this and I'll see the global problems. Then wherever I'll project this, the problems will be solved. I'll try to first of all make the land fertile with this." One photograph of mine, can you imagine? See his projection. I was amazed. I said, "Look at this man, what he has been thinking all the time." He said, "This is not difficult, it's not difficult." I said, "How?" So he showed me with a spring, you know, something like a spring. He put it on water which I had vibrated, and the spring started jumping. And then he showed with his machine that the whole thing was moving so fast, you see, "Mother, just see the water that you have vibrated, how great it is." I said, "This is, I have never heard that you can transform this power into something which will work out on material things." He said, "This power can work out in anything. It is this power which has created everything. So it will work out in everything." I was so surprised. And he said, "I've been just waiting to meet you, and this I'm going to start. I've got a lot of work to be done." And he told his friend, "Now let's go. We have a lot of work to be done. I want to do all this in the lifetime of Mother. She should see what you have to do." I was amazed from where this fellow has dropped on this. Such an experience of a scientist. In the West, no scientist will even look at me. Nobody will think that they can do something about these vibrations. But you see, he has already developed a method by which he can measure the vibrations, you see. I don't know, I didn't ask him any further questions because I thought he's too much in it, and let him do what he likes. And you see, I find that in Russia people are very highly placed and they have very many ideas, but spirituality is the main thing, and morality. There was another gentleman, I would say he was hardly about 30, 32 years of age. very much sparkling, he came. I asked him, what do you want me to do? He said, no, you have done too much for us. Now we'll do for you. So what do you want to do? He said, I'm in charge here of spirituality. Can you imagine? We have no such government where there is a subject like spirituality, that somebody is in charge of spirituality. This is Russia. I said, you are in charge of spirituality, yes. And I have to deal with students from very young age to the college. And can you tell me, mother, at what age the children are more receptive of spirituality? I said, there's no hard and fast rule about it. But as children, they, very small children, because they are so innocent, it works out. So he asked me, how do we put spirituality into them? I said, you can raise their kundalini, you can tie them up, and they will become really people with such attention that you'll be amazed at that. He said, I'm gathering all the people of all the faiths, and I'm going to tell them that it's only Sahaja Yoga which is the right path. Can you imagine? Such a wonderful person, hardly 32 years of age, I mean, one better than the other, I thought. One really better than the other. Then he asked me the schemes. What should we do for patriotism? What should we do for this? He was so much alert, and he said, through spirituality, how can we improve their lives, of the students? Now he is in charge of all the students of Russia. And he is also a member of the parliament. He said, there are other 8-9 members who are also in the same committee, and they want spirituality to come. I was amazed. I mean, what a country is this, Russia? How could they have such people? Then the third one came. He was also member of parliament, very dynamic. First he was right-hand man of Elstein, but then he gave him up. He said, he's not moral. I don't want to have anything to do with a person who's not moral. So now what are you doing? He said, now we are thinking of getting elected by some another party, name is My Motherland. That's a very good idea. So in that we'll not have fixed ideas like it is a democracy or a, you can call it communism or this. But whatever suits My Motherland, that will have. It's a very practical. It's the most practical thing, that whatever will be good for My Mother-in-law, that we will have. Nothing else. I said, really, this is very practical. And he may one day replace this Elstein and all that. Very dynamic, very nice. Just now he was a little bit, I must say, depressed. Because he said, there are stupid people over here and this and that. But then he got very hopeful. I said, we'll help you all out. But such a truthful man. And he said, the basis of human life is morality. If you have no morality, then all the rest is nonsense. He studied in England, and as he said, also in America for quite some time. And the other fellow had said it. And they said, in America we got fed up, absolutely, and we don't want to go back there. So the wisdom of these people really was very striking to me. Now the another third thing which I discovered is even much more deeper than this. When I went to Ukraine, I saw some very nice paintings done with a very aboriginal sort of colors. So they said, Mother, this we had before the Christians came in. They showed me a magazine in which there was a photograph of the primordial mother, and they called it Aditi, that Sanskrit we to call it Aditi. Can you imagine? Then they said this culture existed before the Christian aggression came in. And there was paintings were of Muladhara Chakra in different ways, and also of Agya Chakra. And the way they were talking about all this, even in the magazine I was really surprised. They said that all this was published, we have books on this, but because of the church it was all said, it's all nonsense, there's nothing like that. But the best part I saw was the picture of the Aditi, and there was a kundalini in her stomach, or stomach or lopa, and was shown going upward like that. I said, look at this culture these people had. Then they said, we had relations with India, and they were Aryans and we were also Aryans, and we used to meet them. So I thought Machindranath and all these people had gone to the north of India, they might have come to this Ukraine, and they said that, I mean the whole thing was traced to Ukraine, name came from Kuru, and all kinds of things were traced in Sanskrit, all this, I was amazed. What a culture they had, in what culture they lived. It's something, you know, unbelievable. While in India, there are many people who don't know what is kundalini, if you tell them kundalini, they think kundali means horoscope, especially in the north, they have no idea of kundalini. But here are the people who have really had lived in a culture for thousands of years, and they said this was before Christ 3,000 years. Can you imagine, before Christ 3,000? And so we too had civilizations in India, like Harappa and all that of that time. But they said India is the source of spirituality. That magazine, I was amazed at it and the way it was done. And the Muladhara and the Agya Chakra and all that, so well. Maybe they must have seen it, they might not have got realization. But they talked about realization and also achieving selfhood. This was so many years back. But then they said the Christian religion came and they told us it's all nonsense, I have nothing to do. As they told me also in Greece that they had Athena and primordial mother and all that, but they said, no mother, nothing, better stop it. So it was all cancer and nobody looked at it. But can you imagine that so many years back it existed in that Ukraine, such a beautiful culture of spirituality. First time I went to Ukraine, we had people there, there was a Chernobyl, you know, that was a big explosion, and they were all, like somebody had these fingers cut out or attached to each other, somebody had boils all over the body, somebody's nose was turned like that, and horrible looking, like lepers they were, all of them, those who came to the program. But then this time, more than this were the people there in Ukraine, I must say, much more than that. The whole hall was full, the three-tier was full, the passages were full, and still the people outside were standing. And they said, we were the ones who suffered from this. And now look at us, we are completely cured. You won't believe, I never touched anyone. I was there only once, they came to my program and they got cured. So this sensitivity that they had, I used to wonder why these Russians and Ukrainians are so sensitive to spirituality. Then I realized that these people who have got spirituality is ancient. From ancient times they were practicing this. And we had Machindranath, Gorakhnath, all these people. But nobody practiced Kundalini awakening to this extent that it was in every village they used to make the paintings about Muladhara, about this another Agya Chakra very clearly. And in the Agya Chakra was yin and yang, of the Chinese, can you imagine? After discovering that, I really felt that in the world there must be lots of people like that. Now in Colombia I've seen also, they have the same Kundalini and a Kumbha and everything. I think that's even more than that, 3,000-4,000 years back before Christ. So what we find that we had all this knowledge in all these countries, and still that knowledge is still working in the minds of the people. They're very introspective, and also they know a lot about what is the, is it a, the sun. It is this kind of sensitivity comes only when basically in the roots of that country you have exposure to spirituality. It's a kind of a miraculous revelation one could see there, how they knew everything about Kundalini, about the primordial mother, about this happening, about spirituality, and what happens to a person when he becomes a realized one. The speciality I saw about them, they are extremely humble people. To them I'm really, I don't know how they bow to me, and sometimes I just can't imagine how these people have such sense of spirituality and such peace. When they had this coup, I asked them, aren't you worried? This coup is here and I don't know what will happen to your country. Aren't you worried? He said, Mother, why should we worry? After all, we are in the kingdom of God. We are not living in Russia. We are living in the kingdom of God. So why should we worry? And meeting such nice people there, such sensitive people to spirituality, they have thrown away practically all the false gurus, all the false gurus. And for me they showed such respect and such care, they had this conference only for me. So now why I'm telling you all this, that now you all have got realization. You have now felt your spirit. And you have entered into the kingdom of God, no doubt. But now you must understand that this power that you have, what it does to you, what it creates in you. The most important thing is, by this power you become thoughtlessly aware. That is, you come in the present. To achieve the present is an impossible task. So you, once you are in thoughtless awareness, what happens? That no thoughts bombard your mind. Wherever you may be in America, you may be in any place, you are not bombarded by thoughts. So, what does that mean? Into very simple language we can say, it means that you do not reflect. You do not have a reflecting mind. Now this is the basic problem of Sahaja Yogis of today, which one should try to conquer, that you do not reflect. That's the only way you can achieve your steadiness. For example, I've seen people, for nothing at all, they'll just start laughing. Nothing at all. They see somebody, immediately they react. This was nice, but not so. They start giving their opinion, especially in the West, about everything. Everybody seems to be very knowledgeable, and start telling what is best, what is not the best, what is not good. And once they start saying something like that, mind becomes reflective. If the mind is not reflective, then you are thoughtless awareness. Watch anything, just to watch, just to witness. You should not reflect. If you are using your mental power, then this power subsides. This is a very common defect with people, because I think you people are more intelligent, you think maybe, I think you are well educated, might be, I don't know, whatever you think. But this reflecting mind is a very dangerous thing for spirituality. You'll never grow. And then with the reflecting mind, you have different emotions. With something, you reflect on somebody. Now, if it's your son or daughter or something, you get identified. Identification with some is artificial, it's not in reality. But because of this mind reflects, it identifies. Now many identifications you have dropped out. For example, your bias about religion, about races, about maybe nationalities, you have dropped out. But still, I would say, the reflecting mind still acts. And this is the greatest hurdle for the progress of sadhus of today. I've been thinking, why is it the reflecting mind is so active in sadhus of today? If you could stop reflecting, immediately you establish yourself in the ocean of peace. You watch something, just watch. There's no ripple of thought in your mind. Then you become extremely creative, you become extremely dynamic, you become extremely compassionate. You have no fear. Some people think if you are compassionate, you see this man might lynch me. You have no fear. All virtues that you have to enjoy, you can only enjoy when you do not reflect. That means that you leave everything to the Divine. You have not in charge. You don't see that you have to be reflecting on something. This is the greatest power you have got, is not to reflect, not to look at somebody with that kind of. I have seen this is still there, lingering. Perhaps I never told you about it, maybe one of the reasons. I don't say that it's only your fault, but maybe mine, because I couldn't find what was exactly wrong. That is the reflection that you have about others. Now, I told you, have introspection. For introspection, also it can be reflection. But that at least gives you idea as to where you are. But with that, psychologically you can become extremely depressed, you can condemn yourself. Then you may not understand yourself as a personality that you are. And you'll go on sort of losing your vibrations, losing your power, because you are not in control of yourself. So introspection also, if it brings about depression and demeaning of your personality, best is not to introspect also. Because all these mental activities I've seen create problems. But in a state where you are thoughtlessly aware, introspection comes to you automatically. You see it automatically. You understand it automatically. You do not think about it. Just comes to you. The whole picture comes to you and you are at peace with yourself. You are never in turmoil, never in trouble. Then you don't get angry, then you do not argue, then you do not discuss, but you become as if dropped into the ocean of awareness. And you don't have to worry as to solve something. When you are reflecting, then you find that this power works. Now it becomes very contradictory to say that you have to project and you don't have to reflect. Now when we reflect, we absorb. When we reflect on something, we absorb that thing. And mostly our attention goes to the defects of others. This person is no good, that is not good, this is the hair not all right, the sari is not all right, this, that and all nonsense. So what are we doing? We are absorbing all the bad things also. Now when you start admiration of something, then what happens? That you may not get the bad things, but at least you are on a better line. But still the admiration in thoughtless awareness is really very deep. I saw this in the eyes of this great scientist. Absolutely he was just one with me and his eyes were like an ocean of peace. He was just looking at me. And for quite some time, and then he came to his thoughts and he told me that this is what we can do with your photograph. So the depth in you will only come when you do not reflect. But it's very common with human beings, especially in the West. This carpet is no good, that is no good, this smell is coming, that is there. Always trying to judge others. Judge other things, which is important. What is so important? If you are sitting in the garden of heavens, what does it matter where you are sitting, what you are doing? This sets in, this reflection sets in waves of thoughts in our mind. I have already once described it by drawing, how the energy that falls on the right side goes to the left side and the falls on the left goes to the right, crosses over because of two types of cells we have. Then out of this energy that goes to the right, the energy that goes to the left, it is sucked in partly into the sympathetic. Now whatever is left out is the one that reflects. That is the way it goes on reflecting. Now if you can suck in all that energy and put it on our sympathetic, then all our energies will be thousandfold much more. We'll not be tired, we'll not be unhappy, we'll be able to stand lots of nonsense. But we'll not call it a nonsense, we'll not think it's a bad thing, so it has no effect on us. This quality we have to develop. I would say with this today's special celebration of Navratri, like yesterday you saw the Durga's nine forms also. In that is one is Kushmanda, as this was told. That you absorb all the filth within yourself, in your stomach. But Devi does that, not you. What a Devi can do, you should not do. That's her job, that she is supposed to do this, not you. What you have to do is to only be in silence so that you absorb whatever will increase that silence, will increase your depth. Devi will look after all the other rest of the things. She look after the all the filth, all the anger, all the temper, all the everything that's going on in this world. She will absorb all that. But what you have to do is to just enjoy everything that is pure. Enjoyment is only possible when you are beyond your mind. With your mind you can never enjoy. It's like a big load. It will not act, it will not help. Enjoyment comes when you are in complete silence, in a ripple-less lake, the reflection of all the joy that is created on the shores of that lake are completely reflected. They are not deflected. If there were ripples, it would have been a different image altogether and would have been something nowhere near the image of reality. So one must have a mind which is kept lower than reality. In the reality, actually it is nothing but peace and joy. Now a mother's desire is always that children should have nothing but peace and joy. No sufferings, no starvation, no ordeals, nothing. They must just enjoy. Now those days are gone. But even to enjoy this, even to live in that complete peaceful state, you have to be non-reflective. Now you watch yourself. You'll be amazed how much reflecting we are. When Devi is doing all the job for you, when Parama Chaitanya, I don't know how many things it is doing, is trying to fill up the whole atmosphere with its activity, what is your activity should be to stop your mental activity. You'll be amazed, in that state only you will grow. With that growth only, you will become like this scientist. How the contradiction now is that when you have your depth, you can project your depth, not your mind. Sometimes when I say project, people think it's a projection of the mind. No. You have to project that depth, that reality that is within you. For that, you don't have to think, you don't have to plan, it will just work. But you be the instrument for that projection. It's nothing subtle, it is very simple to understand. Like I am talking on this instrument, all right? Now if this instrument is absolutely all right, there's no problem in it, it will be peaceful. But if this is full of ideas and thoughts like our brain is, whatever I'm saying will not be the same that will be broadcast. In the same way, when our mind is full of turmoil and arguments and what you can say, comments, or we can also say the reflection, then what happens that this mind gets into like a whirlpool of disturbances and it cannot project itself fully because it is disturbed. It is not a normal thing. So now you'll understand there's no contradiction. You can only project yourself when you are absolutely peaceful. And this is what we have to learn. This is Navratri's great days are here, and that you should know that it starts actually in the Western world from the 21st, in the equinox, after the equinox in September. There are two Navratris we have, see. One starts now and one starts after the second equinox. Now in this equinox, Mother Mary's birthday is the equinox. And that's why people celebrate her birthday. They don't know why she was born on equinox, see, for the balance. Then, you see, because nothing was explained about the lives of these great incarnations, people use them the way they like, because they have seen miracles with them, so they do not try to understand why this equinox. and why this is celebrated. Now, I was told in Iran, this is the time they have the New Year. That means the Muslims observe this as a New Year. So, when Navratri starts, is the New Year. That means it's the 12th month for them. And so many things are suggestive of that, that why should it be 12 months? Why should the goddess be born at 12 o'clock? All this has a special meaning and which you can find out, but only possible when you are not reflecting. This is what is the state in which you are really in connection with the all-pervading power. Otherwise, you are not there. You are not one with that state. To be one with that state, you have to be absolutely silent within yourself. For the goddess, she is silent. There's a fight on, she's silent. Because she's so confident. She knows about her powers. She knows Mahishasur or any sur cannot trouble her, cannot touch her. She knows what are their powers are, and she knows all her powers. So she doesn't have to be disturbed by anything. She's not disturbed. Because she's really the personification of this peace state, where she's so powerful. She doesn't have to know about her powers, she doesn't have to ask the powers to exert. They just work automatically. This is the state in which you will be amazed, so many things happen unknowingly, without your doing anything. And that is what we call as coincidences. But actually it's not coincidence. It is the state in which we are in a thoughtless awareness, and then the Paramachaitanya is related to us, absolutely related, we are there. And that works out everything for us. So, in Sahaja Yoga, this time, as you know about the goddess, what she has done, so much work for years together, now you all have become realized souls. And you must understand that complete confidence in yourself, complete understanding about yourself, never to have any fear, never to have any thoughts which can bombard your mind. At that state you are the most powerful person. I hope for this Navratri you will realize what work the goddess has done for you, how much she's worked hard, how much she's fought, she's been fighting with these horrible devils and rakshasas. And sometimes I feel now, these devils are within us. They're not outside. And that comes to us because we reflect too much on things. If you talk to any one of the Western people, you are amazed as if all the media they have on their heads. They know about each and every person, what he did, what was this, what was that. But he's not worried. He doesn't think how he can improve it, how you can work it out. At this state of thoughtless awareness, you encompass the whole universe, and at that state, this power works wherever the problem may be. So we have to understand our value, that we have this power within ourselves. And this is to be respected and to give credit to the goddess, because she's done so much work for us that she should not feel that it's now that they got realization just for a song and they are not bothered, they don't know how to develop it. She will not be in any way hurt, but her work, what she has done, we have to see, we have to understand We have to have a feeling that somehow, as we now have got enlightenment, we should try to be people as complete instruments of that power. That's only possible when you don't have your own ideas, your own interference. Complete instrument, just like as I said, this instrument has to be perfectly all right, otherwise it cannot work. Thank you very much. May God bless you.